So welcome everybody. So as we gather, it doesn't matter whether we're gathering at home or whether we're gathering together. We are reminded that whenever we gather, we are gathering on lands that are by law the unceded territories of the Mi'kmaq people. We gratefully and respectfully acknowledge this. And so as we begin our worship, we light our Christ candle. And as we do so, we are reminded to take the light of Christ with us wherever we go. I invite you now to join me in our call to worship. We gather here this morning to settle into the comfortable rituals and familiar patterns of worship at a time when so many of the things that are comfortable and familiar to us are not possible. We gather distanced from one another through the gift of technology. Yet even as we distance ourselves from one another, we recognize that there is one who is connected to us. We recognize that there is one who is as close to us as our own breath and our own heartbeat. And so as we gather here today, we join with one another and with all of creation as we worship the one who unites us and makes us one. Our opening prayer this morning was one that I found, and I immediately thought it had been written during the time of COVID. I quickly realized, however, that it was actually written before 2005. But the words offered by Bill Stedman seem so appropriate for what is happening right now that I've chosen to use it for our opening prayer today. So please join me in our opening prayer. Let us pray. We live in times of uncertainty, God. And so we find ourselves filled with questions. Questions about the meaning and purpose of life. Questions about the future of our world. Questions about the ways in which our leaders govern. Questions about the value of faith in a time of warfare, hatred, and despair. We are here because we cannot live alone. We are here seeking to renew a sense of your spirit within us, around us, and among us. Lead us to the light of your truth and the hope of the ages. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our opening hymn today is All People That on Earth Do Dwell.
that. Oh, now I come in.
He asked the apostles, tells the story of how the followers of Jesus continued to spread the gospel after his death. Most of the stories contained in Acts focus on Peter and Paul. But today we hear the story of the ministry of Philip and how he spread the good news to an Ethiopian officer whom he also baptized.
This is from chapter 8 of Acts, verses 26 to 39 from the Good News Translation. An angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Get ready and go south to the road that goes from Jerusalem to Gaza. This road is not used nowadays." So Philip got ready and went. Now an Ethiopian eunuch, who was an important official in charge of the treasury of the Queen of Ethiopia, was on his way home. He had been to Jerusalem to worship God and was going back home in his carriage. As he rode along, he was reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Holy Spirit said to Philip, "Go over to that carriage and stay close to it." Philip ran over and heard him reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. He asked him, "Do you understand what you are reading?" The official replied, "How can I understand unless someone explains it to me?" And he invited Philip to climb up and sit in the carriage with him. The passage of scripture which he was reading was this: "He was like a sheep that is taken to be slaughtered, like a lamb that makes no sound when its wool is cut off. He did not say a word. He was humiliated, and justice was denied him. No one will be able to tell about his descendants, because his life on earth has come to an end." The official asked Philip, "Tell me, of whom is the prophet saying this? Of himself or of someone else?" Then Philip began to speak. Starting from this passage of scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. As they traveled down the road, they came to a place where there was some water. And the official said, "Here is some water. What is to keep me from being baptized?" The official ordered the carriage to stop, and both Philip and the official went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord took Philip away. The official did not see him again, but continued on his way, full of joy.
Although Psalm 22 begins with words of deep lament, the section that we're reading today focuses exclusively on praise and adoration, and on the importance of telling others about God.
From Psalm 22, verses 25 through 31. "In the full assembly, I will praise you for what you have done. In the presence of those who worship you, I will offer the sacrifices I promised. The poor will eat as much as they want. Those who come to the Lord will praise him. May they prosper forever. All nations will remember the Lord. From every part of the world, they will turn to him. All races will worship him. The Lord is king, and he rules the nations. All proud people will bow down to him. All mortals will bow down before him. Future generations will serve him. They will speak of the Lord to the coming generation. People not yet born will be told, 'The Lord saved his people.'"
The first letter of John focuses a great deal on love and what love is. It contains the familiar passage, "God is love." But the section we hear this morning talks about love from a practical form. Our love should not be just words and talk. It must be true love, which shows itself in action.
From 1 John chapter 3, verses 16 through 24. This is how we know what love is. Christ gave his life for us. We too then ought to give our love, our lives for others. If we are rich and see others in need, yet close our hearts against them, how can we claim that we love God? My children, our love should not be just words and talk. It must be true love, which shows itself in action. This, then, is how we will know that we belong to the truth. This is how we will be confident in God's presence. If our conscience condemns us, we know that God is greater than our conscience and that he knows everything. And so, my dear friends, if our conscience does not condemn us, we have courage in God's presence. We receive from him whatever we ask, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. What he commands is that we believe in his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as Christ commanded us. Those who obey God's commands live in union with God, and God lives in union with them. And because of the Spirit that God has given us, we know that God lives in union with us.
Our gospel reading contains a familiar image of Jesus as the vine to which we as the branches must cling. It also contains the image of God as the gardener who tends both the vine and the branches, taking care of all.
From John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. I am the real vine. And my Father is the gardener. He breaks off every branch in me that does not bear fruit, and he prunes every branch that does bear fruit, so that it will be clean and bear more fruit. You have been made clean already by the teaching I have given you. Remain united to me, and I will remain united to you. A branch cannot bear fruit by itself. It can do so only if it remains in the vine. In the same way, you cannot bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. Those who remain in me, and I in them, will bear much fruit, for you can do nothing without me. Those who do not remain in me are thrown out like a branch and dry up. Such branches are gathered up and thrown into the fire where they are burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, then you will ask for anything you wish and you shall have it. My Father's glory is shown by your bearing much fruit, and in this way you become my disciples.
The story of Philip's encounter with the Ethiopian is at least somewhat familiar to most people who attend church regularly. But the story always seems to get lost in the lectionary when the story of the vine and the branches is also included this week. However, there's a great deal in the story of Philip and the Ethiopian that we don't always think about. And there's some interesting lessons that we can learn from this story. First, it is clear that this Ethiopian is a man of great status and influence. He's not only literate, but he apparently owns at least one scroll, something that at the time would have been very expensive. We are also told that he has traveled to Jerusalem to worship, and that he is now returning home in his own carriage. Both these things would indicate that the man is a man of some wealth who also has the ability to take time away from work in order to travel. We're told that he was an important official in charge of the treasury of the Queen of Egypt, or of Ethiopia. This, along with the fact that he is referred to as a eunuch, would suggest that he is someone who had close and frequent contact with the queen herself. Male servants were often castrated to ensure that there was no chance of them having sexual relations with the queen or with any of the palace harem. This also ensured that they would not try to overthrow the king and set up their own dynasty, since they would have no sons to pass that dynasty on to. For these reasons, it is likely that this man was a very close and trusted member of the royal household. The other thing that we can be relatively certain of is that this man was a convert to the Jewish faith. He'd come to Jerusalem to worship, and he was reading the scroll of Isaiah. However, he was probably not raised in a Jewish household, since if he had been, he would have been taught to understand the traditional meaning of the scroll of Isaiah as a child, and would have been unlikely to ask Philip to explain it. Meanwhile, Philip, who was one of the first disciples of Jesus, heard the Spirit calling him to take the road from Jerusalem to Gaza. It was there that he encountered the Ethiopian. As he walked along, Philip heard the Ethiopian reading the scroll and was moved to ask, "Do you understand what you're reading?" Now, the Ethiopian's answer may seem very simple and straightforward, but if we stop to think about it, it can actually tell us a lot. How can I understand unless someone explains it to me? Have you ever heard someone say, "I don't need to go to church because I read the Bible at home every day"? Well, they may well read the Bible, but I can't help but wonder how deeply they actually read. I would love to respond to them with the question that the Ethiopian asks Philip. How can any of us understand what Scripture is telling us unless someone explains it? If we know nothing about the time or circumstance under which a passage was written, if we read it only from our modern fact-based understanding of the written word, how can we draw out from it meaning that is relevant for us today? If you actually look at the stories in our Bible about times when the scripture is read in public, they're almost always followed by a time of teaching and discussion. From the very first time we are told that Jesus attended the temple at the age of 12, we are told that he not only listened to the scripture being read, but he also asked questions and discussed the scriptures with the rabbis. We are told that when he was asked to read scripture in the synagogue in Nazareth, he finished reading and then sat down to teach. Jesus was often quoted asking people if they understood the scripture. When he taught using parables, he frequently took time later to explain them to his disciples because they did not understand. And Jesus was not starting something new by doing this. It was the tradition in the synagogue for a rabbi to read a passage of scripture and then sit down and discuss its meaning with all those gathered there. Despite what we sometimes appear to think, scripture was never intended to be read or understood in isolation. It has always been read and interpreted in community. So when the Ethiopian invites Philip to join him in the carriage and explain the scriptures that he's been reading, this is not something that was extraordinarily rare. It would have been very normal to invite anyone who heard the scripture and wanted to take time to discuss it. It's interesting to note that the scripture tells us that when the Ethiopian asked Philip who Isaiah was talking about in the scripture, it was not, Philip did not say that the scripture referred to Jesus. Instead, we're told that starting from that passage of scripture, Philip told him about the good news of Jesus. It's not about having one answer and only one answer to every question. It's about a conversation. It's about a discussion and an interaction, a sharing of ideas and understanding. It's not enough to set out a series of facts or to explain things from a specific point of view. There has to be some connection for the conversation to become more than just a lecture. It's about learning in community. For the Ethiopian and Philip, the result of this interaction was that the Ethiopian felt moved to commit himself to follow the way of Jesus and requested that Philip baptize him. The conversation and the interaction had changed him, but I'm sure it also changed Philip. Any time that we truly connect with another person, when we're willing to honestly share our thoughts and ideas, and when we're willing to listen deeply to the thoughts and ideas of another, when we're willing to search for answers and figure things out together, the experience will change both of those involved. It doesn't mean that the two will always come to exactly the same conclusion. And it may mean accepting that there may not be one and only one right answer. But it is in the connection and in the sharing of ideas and opinions that growth happens. Same thing can be seen in our gospel reading from this morning. We sometimes think of the image of the vine and the branches as a one-way relationship. The vine feeds the branches. Now, if that's all there was to it, the idea of reading scripture in isolation would seem to fit. As long as we're connected to the vine, that's all we need. But a vine doesn't really work that way. It is true that the sap that nourishes the branches comes up from the vine, which is actually the stem or the trunk of the plant itself, and it spreads out to the branches. But the vine itself can only produce that sap when it is nurtured by the leaves that grow on the branches. It's the leaves that convert the sun's energy into the food the plant needs. The food must travel back through the branches to the vine or trunk. The branches must be an active part of the whole system in order for it to work. They cannot simply sit back and passively wait to receive without ever giving back. We cannot simply sit back and absorb our faith. We cannot simply expect to be taught and to have our faith delivered to us with no expectation in return. In order for our faith to grow, we must become an active part of that growth. If Jesus is the vine and we are the branches, there must be a connection and an exchange between us and Christ. But for our faith to be healthy and grow, there must also be a connection and an exchange with each other. It is in community, in the connections between God and us, and in the connections that we have with each other, that we are able to not just absorb, but to process and to grow from what we learn. This is why we gather here today, to listen, to discuss, to learn, and to worship our gardener, God. Amen. Our next hymn is "Today We All Are Called to Be Disciples." At this time in our worship, we are reminded of our commitment to God. And we're reminded that commitment also includes the gifts we offer. Normally, we would ask God's blessing upon the gifts that are placed on our offering plate, as well as the gifts we offer through PAR or through online donations. But today, there are no offering plates. So instead, we remind people that as well as PAR and online donations, people can also drop donations off at the church using the mail slot at the left entry of the office entry. But we need to also remember that our financial contributions are not the only thing that we have to offer. We offer our time, our talents, our abilities, our commitment, and our prayers. And so, whatever it is that we have to offer today, let us ask God to bless it. Let us pray. Loving God, whatever gifts we have to offer, we ask that you would bless them, that they may become blessings to others. Amen. And now I would ask that we take a few moments to offer our own silence prayers for all those who are on our thoughts and minds this day, and for all those whose needs and concerns are known only to God. Amen. And I believe Pam has our minute for mission.
That's right. This is entitled, You Are There Every Step of the Way, Jason's Story. There's a saying, you can't understand another person's experience until you've walked a mile in their shoes. Today, there are 2,900 active and aspiring ministry personnel in the United Church of Canada, and you have traveled alongside them in their journey. Your gifts through mission and service support ministry students every step of the way by helping with education costs and providing some financial support. The Reverend Jason Myers, a new ordinand, didn't grow up in the church. It was through a series of events that happened in my life, through brokenness and suffering, and having the person of Jesus influence how my life was unfolding, that ministry became an option, he explained. After his son was born, Jason couldn't ignore the call to ministry he had felt for some time. After Isaiah was baptized, our minister asked me to write Isaiah a letter that he would read when Isaiah is confirmed as a teenager. I started to write things like, Isaiah, I want you to follow your dreams and follow what God is calling you to do in your life. I realized that I wasn't doing that in my own life. The day after writing the letter to his son, Jason walked to a theological college to learn more about ministry education. A few years later, Jason was heading off on another walk, this time to his ordination ceremony. The journey started at Emmanuel College in Toronto and ended in Barrie, Ontario, a two-week, 225-kilometer-long spiritual pilgrimage. As he walked, Jason reflected on his journey with God and prepared himself spiritually for ordination and ministry. That was in 2019. Since then, what has surprised Jason most about ministry is his expanding capacity to love. I thought that when my kids were born, that was kind of the size my heart would be. But I've come to love the church, the people, and the vocation of ministry more deeply than I ever imagined. I'm so thankful that Jesus reached into my life and invited me on this journey with him. And what would Jason say to those whose generosity has supported his journey to ordination through mission and service? I'd say it's worth it. The church is alive and vibrant, and it's worth investing in. The leaders are working hard and are bringing the best of themselves into the ministry, into the church, and into the world. Please give a gift through mission and service. Through your gifts, you show you care about quality ministry leadership. Thanks to your generosity, love is there, training and supporting leaders every step of the way.
Let us join our hearts in prayer. God, this is not where we hope to be this week. We had hoped to gather in our beautiful sanctuary, talking and laughing together, waving to each other across the social distance of pews and aisles. Instead, we gather together seeing each other only on the screen or hearing each other's voices only through the telephone. We wish things were different. Yet we know that the wisdom offered us by the health care authorities of our province and our country are helping to keep us safe. And for this, we are grateful. We are vividly aware that not everyone has been as fortunate as we are. In our own country, there are places where the situation is far worse. And across the world, there are stories of incredible suffering and devastation caused by the virus we are fighting. Remind us to be aware of the suffering of others. Remind us that although we may be focused so intently on the COVID virus, there are many other forms of suffering in our world that have often been made worse by the pandemic or that have gotten lost in the global focus. We pray for those who are ill from diseases or conditions that have nothing to do with COVID. Those who have found it hard to access medical help during this time, and those who have lost their medical needs and treatment has been put on hold because of the overflowing hospitals and the overwhelming demands on medical personnel. We pray for those living in poverty who find it especially hard to adhere to health regulations. Those who cannot self-isolate because they have no safe home. Those who cannot provide healthy food and a safe environment for themselves or their families. Those who live in the reality of overcrowded refugee camps or overcrowded neighborhoods where social distancing is not possible. We pray for those whose main focus today is not COVID, but simply the struggle to survive in the midst of war, terrorism, or starvation that affects so many in our world. Remind us that although COVID may have been the focus of our intention, we still have much to do to live out your call to care for others. God, help us to do our part to bring peace and wholeness to our world. And remind us that no matter the circumstances, we walk with you and you call us to walk with one another, caring for our neighbors, whoever they may be. Thank you for your promise to be with us and guide us always to follow your path of love for all. Amen. And our closing hymn today is Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. So we may be physically distanced, but we are not alone. God is with us. Christ's example leads us, and the Spirit guides us and accompanies us every step of the way. So as we go out from here, let us go with God. Amen.